by about 1860, one could say that childhood had been fully invented and established and consolidated. It existed now, so that the upper classes, and then by imitation, the middle classes, had a special set of arrangements for dealing with childhood. There were nannies and perambulators and sailor suits for childhood, all established by about 1860s, 70s.
Come with the hoop and come with the ladder and down the wall.
Housing your happy chimney corner days, sitting safe in nursery nooks, reading pictures. Toying a group of young folks. Here's a wagon well laden, and here is a dray with horses and harness. Filled with little masters and misses who hurried joyfully into the house, talking and laughing all the way up the stairs. Summer fading, winter comes. Frosty mornings, tingling thumbs, winter robins, winter night when Freddy went to bed. Strange thoughts were going through his head.
Nobody's not clean and neat, with lots of toys and things to eat.
He is a naughty child, I'm sure. Or else his dear papa is poor.
And so by the middle of the century, childhood had happened. For the middle classes, that is. But not for the poor. Crowded together in the alleys and the back streets where back-to-back houses so bulged and overflowed with children that it was hard to shut the door on them. A world of pale faces, coarse humor, ragged children and sickly parents. The struggle for life was desperate. These were the children of the Industrial Revolution. Working class children had always worked alongside their parents for centuries in the fields, but life was transformed by the Industrial Revolution. Children of 5 or 6 were laboring 12 and 14 hours a day in the pits and in the factories. These facts hardly squared with the image of innocence and vulnerability surrounding the children of the middle classes. Reformers used this stark difference as a lever for reform. Contrast this with the evidence given to the Royal Commission investigating the treatment of children.
She stood shivering before me from cold. The rag that hung about her waist, which was once called a shift, was saturated with water and was as black as the coal she thrusts. She works for 12 hours a day from 2 in the morning to 2 in the afternoon, bearing 100 weight of coal upon her back. So burdened, she climbs up the ladders and crawls through tunnels 4 feet high. However incredible it may seem, I've taken evidence from fathers who have ruptured themselves straining to lift coal onto their children's backs.
And so they passed laws first to limit and then to abolish child labor. It was the first time that people had ever thought or argued that children should not work. At the beginning of the 19th century, Children had provided a cheap pool of unskilled labor. Later, there was a demand for skilled labor. In school, they learnt the three R's and habits of punctuality, regularity, and obedience. Qualities highly valued by factory owners.
The children spent a lot of time learning the catechism and the habits and attitudes which were appropriate to young people who were, after all, going to be doing very humdrum, routine, largely manual jobs. They were taught industry, habits of frugality, honesty, perseverance, and so forth. And I think that these habits were quite as much as important as anything they learned about the three R's. And the way in which they were taught in the schools was almost the same as the way in which they were controlled and monitored inside the factory.
By the end of the century, schooling became universal and compulsory, so like it or lump it, everybody had some sort of childhood, even the poor.
The 20th century, an everyday story of crises and disasters. England began to lose her empire. Foreigners inexplicably wanted to rule themselves. The Titanic sank. And someone spent 10,000 million pounds putting men on the moon. The troubles in Ireland got really bad, even by Irish standards.
And of course the St. Patrick on you.
And wars got global. The First World War. The Second World War. The Third World War, which was, thank goodness, a Cold War. Only in the Tower did things improve. It is opened up to American tourists.
Gee, I love your crown jewels.
Now, in this century, recently, a new kind of child picture has come into being. That's to say, a painting or a reproduction of a painting, which is just of a child, which is no longer a portrait, it's no longer the child you know, it is just the idea of the child. First of all, his clothes are rather old-fashioned. They just very vaguely suggest that that was about how long ago? 20 years? 30 years? Why? Because that was the period of the childhood of the adults who are now likely to buy it. At the same time, it's not actually dateable, so it can refer perhaps to their own son. It's quite a sad picture. The boy is just on the verge of tears. The tear on his cheek is almost the tear of nostalgia, of the adult as he remembers his own childhood or as he thinks that the childhood of his own children will end. Now it is a question of the innocence of childhood, but an innocence which is about to be lost. Nostalgic for his own childhood. And all this, of course, is completely artificial, in that children are not sad for that kind of reason. Children don't cry like that at all. I mean, the anguish of children is something quite, quite different.
Children are, in fact, adults, just slightly behind. They're not children, not little elves. They weren't found under a cabbage patch. They're miniature adults.
I really rather do dislike a kind of child culture which is manufactured by adults and then imposed on children. In fact, through the media. I remember when I was a child, I really rather disliked child language, which one was taught by adults.
Who's a pretty boy then? Can you see the woo-woo?
The role of child in some societies isn't very different from that of an adult. That's true of the Middle Ages. The role of child in our society is very different. Well, sometimes children don't want to be that different from their parents.
When you're grown up, you can have a family, you can have a nice job, and you can go to work. And you can be famous when you're older, but when you're little, you just muck around.
We sort of have to work. We don't get no money, but when you work, you get money, and you pass your exams, and it's much more easier for you.
The grown-up says you can't, you have to stay with me, and they'll push you around and smack you.
When you're adults, you can just go out when you like. You can go out to nightclubs and all that.
Adults get a lot of satisfactions through their children. They like to dress them. They use them as status symbols. They get all kinds of satisfaction through their achievements in education. They invest in their children, if you like, in all kinds of ways.
Linda Dougal and Mara Seward in the Boston Two-Step. A performance their great-grandmothers might have envied.
Children express what the adults have put into them. They are brought up by adults. And the adults, therefore, are almost writing a kind of a version of their society into their children.
Sugar and spice, laced with some puppy dog's tails, was the bill of fare at the finals of the United Kingdom Child of the Year contest. Somewhere among the 3 to 7-year-old finalists, there was a budding Miss World or Mr. Universe of the 1980s.
We sort of impose childhood on them, if you like. We start off by tearing them away from their mothers and putting them in a special place. We call it school. And there are the new people in charge of them there, responsible for them, in authority over them. We call them teachers.
And we're now changing over into metric measurement and metric weighing.
These schools are places in which they get special kind of knowledge that they don't get in the family.
New measurements, names that will sound strange, names that probably your parents won't know.
A study that's just done recently shows that children resent very strongly the way adults treat them in our culture. They don't believe them, they suspect them of lying, they interfere into their personal private matters, they open their letters, they don't... They visit them with all kinds of punishments, which they would certainly not try on fellow adults, but they will with children. And the hostility reflects itself now, increasingly, of course, at the latest phase in life, in the whole development of a youth culture, a world which is quite separate from that of adults, and indeed often hostile to it. We know that young people are maturing earlier in every sense, physically and also socially. They are now, therefore, expecting things, wanting things, knowing things, far in advance of the children of 10 or 20 years ago even.
Kids! I don't know what's wrong with these kids today. Kids who can understand anything they say.
Whether it be physical maturation or social maturation is something that's taking place very much earlier. And that's why you're getting, amongst other things, tremendous resistance, the attempt to keep children young, to keep them childish.
Kids, they are disobedient, disrespectful oafs.
And this is a very frustrating situation. Apart from all the things that young people, of course, find wrong with their society, including their education institutions, which have not changed and caught up with modern times.
No compulsory school uniform. No caning.
What's the matter with kids today?
If we really understood what is special about childhood and what the potentiality of children are, which is then quite consistently knocked out of them so that they then become adults like the rest of us, if we really understood that, we would then begin to be able to understand how badly we live, how badly our society is organized.
It would seem then that once invented, the institution of childhood has kept on growing. Children mature physically earlier and earlier, and yet the school leaving age goes up and up. The relationship between adults and children is already beginning to break down, and both are beginning to ask if the separation of their lives has perhaps gone too far. That childhood perhaps has been over-invented. And don't forget that once upon a time, in the distant, far-off days, there was no childhood at all. And that is the end of the story.
The big item of the day, naturally, is the final of the beauty contest. Average vital statistics, 18, 19 and a half, 22. Ambitions from left to right, to be a model, to be a model, to be a model. This sort of thing would go to any girl's head, wouldn't it? But in the end, the judges decide on Sandra. Who said freckles were a drawback?